Welcome to my Bob Thurman podcast. I'm so grateful some good friends enabled me to present them to you. If you enjoy them and find them useful, please think of becoming a member of Tibet House US to help preserve Tibetan culture. Tibet House is the Dalai Lama's cultural center in America. All best wishes. Have a great day.
This is episode number 13, titled Mistaken Guru Yoga and Meditation with Gelek Rimpoche and Bob.
Okay, reverence to the holy gurus, right? Okay, that is very important. I'm not trying to introduce you a guru trip. We had enough guru trip in the West, I believe. We're not interested. However, what we call as spiritual friend, spiritual guide, is an important, one important step here. Very important step. Because as I'm telling you this morning, the spiritual path, what we're going to travel, is an unknown path. Right? So even the knowing things, like, you know, daily work, carpentry or any other art work that you do, even for that you need a teacher who shows you how to use these things. You needed somebody to show you how things work, right? Even in cooking, you need a cook teacher who will show you how to cut the vegetables, how to cut the meat in a certain way. Right? Even for artists, somebody has to teach you how to hold the pens, how to draw things, how the lines and all these sort of things. Everywhere you need a guide, you need a master. And the spiritual path is specially unknown, so you definitely need one very important guide. It's very important. Without that, you read certain books here, you read certain books there, You follow certain lectures, you follow certain here, you follow certain there, and what you do is a spiritual shopping, what I call it. Good spiritual shopping, and when you go home, you have nothing. You go very big shopping, and have a very good spiritual trips here, there, and at the end, in you, what you really have, you have nothing. You really get a zero level. Okay? That won't help. That won't help. Another thing is, the spiritual path is another thing. I may tell you here, frankly, by reading a book, you can never get it. Never get it. Never. Never get it. Spiritual path is never worked by reading a book. Okay? Why? I tell you reason. Otherwise, you may think, what is this fellow trying to tell me? Okay? Why it doesn't work? As I told you, the enlightenment, if this morning we talk, difficult, how difficult it is. Okay? To achieve that, it is not a technical thing. You know, if it's a technical thing, you put this board, this switchboard, this screw here, that screw there, and then you put it, it will start moving, right? Tuck, tuck, tuck. But this is not a technical thing. You have to have, you know, how the spiritual development obtains with individual people. Important is part you have to practice, which means concentrated and analytical meditation. Side by side, you need purification. Side by side, you need accumulation of merit. Side by side, you need a spiritual support. Spiritual support is the only through a spiritual friend you can get. It is this support. When I try to talk to you here, it's not me I'm talking to you, truly spiritual. My backbone is my spiritual lineage. The spiritual lineage behind me is my backbone. I'm nobody. I know nothing. But when I'm trying to talk to you, talk to anybody, not you or anybody, on the spiritual path, I get something to say. I may be able to communicate. I may be able to help quite a number of people. I have been able to help, and I hope I will be able to. It is all because of the backbones of the spiritual lineage. Okay? So, it is important. Important, no doubt. But what we don't need is the guru trips, not what we have. Or what has been introduced by the cultural influence that we just talked before lunch. That's what we don't need it. However, we do need the backbone. So we don't need the Eastern way of a guru trip, but we do need the Western way of a spiritual friendship. It's definitely needed. Without that, again, one won't move. All these things are dependent, okay? The major meditation practice, both analytical and concentrated. Accumulation of a merit, purification, spiritual support, all moves together, then the person moves. If one is missing, it is like a flat tire. If the car has four wheels, if one goes flat tire, you won't move. In that manner it is. So that spiritual friend is important. That's why the reverence to the Holy Guru business comes first. Okay? So you have to understand it. The language is the one language. You have to borrow it. You have to use it. Okay? The word of the guru, you have to use it. Because that was the valuable word. But you have to understand differently. You know what I'm talking about? I hope. As a matter of fact, this was referred as the root of spiritual development. These very projects of the what we call it guru yoga, it is special yoga on them. Yoga, you know what yoga is, well. So it is guru yoga is the root of all development. It's called root of all development. So it is important. Then rises the question, what kind of guru? What are the qualities the person needed? What are the qualities do I look for? Is every single human being who claims to be a spiritual master, is that the right? I don't believe so. Truly speaking, I do not believe so. In traditionally, what we do is even from Tibet, we used to go, we used to select the best, the young, intelligent, intellect people, valuable. 20, 30 of them selected. Goes to India to find a good spiritual master who look everywhere and very, very difficult to find even at that time. So as in Tibet, there are very famous masters. Very famous. But every famous master may not be the right spiritual master for you. And the spiritual master is definitely not going after a big name, for sure. The big name will not help, definitely. And especially the spiritual master who advertises him or herself in the newspapers are bound to be a fraud. Now really, so traditionally people used to carry a load at the back and go and search for year after year for a perfect master. Nowadays, you have the perfect masters available in the New York Times. Or any other bulletin that goes out, right? So, well, anyway, that is just a joke. Forget about it, okay? So, but it is very important to have to choose a good spiritual guide. If the spiritual guide is good and will be able to lead the friend to the enlightenment, you have a very good spiritual friend. You know, it is almost like a duplicating, you know. It's like a mole. You know, it's like a mole. You know what a mole is? Am I using mole? Okay. Mold, okay? Whatever that shape and the picture, that you're going to be duplicating it. So it is very important to have a good one. If you have a wrong spiritual guide, then you have, it's bad, really bad. For example, during the Buddha's period, this famous story of Angulimala, which is very familiar with number of people, I believe, particularly those who read Jataka story, Angulimala. There's somebody had a spiritual master who tells him, if you kill 1,000 human beings 1 week and cut their thumbs and make a mala, mala is rosary, and wear it and come back to me and I liberate you. And the fellow goes and killing everybody, every single human being that he can catch. And he killed 999 human beings. And later, town in India, everybody ran away. By the time 900 was going on, it was more and more harder and harder for him. Right? And ultimately, he has nobody around. He cannot see any human being. The moment he comes, everybody ran away. He can't see anybody. He can't encounter with anybody. He doesn't want to kill his own mother. The mother is the only one who left. So he's hesitating there for a little while. And if nobody gets, he has to take that. He's going to do that. So by that time, Buddha appears in front of him as an ordinary orange guy. Yeah, ordinary bhikshu, okay, monk or bandit. So he started walking slowly in front of him. And he's running, he said, oh, I saw that fellow, now I can get him, so I can spare my mother. He started running after him, he's going slowly. He said, he's running, he couldn't catch him. He said, hey, wait. He said, I'm waiting, you come faster. He's not catching him. That is how they started the dialogue. Hey, wait. He said, I'm waiting, you come faster. This is how they started. And the Buddha started talking to him. He's going, he couldn't catch him. And this is how, finally, he be able to convince him what he's doing is wrong. Okay, my time is more beyond up, so I'll stop here.
Master, the spiritual master. And Atisha said, to know the word of the spiritual master is more important. He said, this is what he said. He said, even if you know by heart all the suttas and all the shastras, he said, if the word of the master has not entered into your heart, then at the time of practice, person and dharma will go separate ways. So this is famous statement by Atisha, and it relates to one of the special greatnesses of Tibetan Buddhism, that in Tibetan Buddhism, the personal relationship, and this is what Rinpoche was talking about, the personal relationship between teacher, whether teacher is a monastic preceptor, whether teacher is what is called Kalyana Mitra, which Rinpoche was referring to, which means spiritual friend. In the ordinary Mahayana, the universal vehicle, the teacher relationship, the authority aspect of it is de-emphasized, and the teacher is talked about as a spiritual friend, Kalyana Mitra, which emphasizes that you have to travel the path yourself, you have to have the realization yourself by calling that teacher a friend in that way. However, in Tantrayana, the guru as a symbol is very, very important, not only as a person, but the guru, even the guru can be an idiot, a fool, a charlatan even, if the disciple in Tantra has great faith in that guru and is looking for the Buddha in even the idiotic behavior of that guru, it is said that the disciple with true faith can find the Buddha's teaching in the idiotic behavior of the guru. So in Tantra, the guru relationship is very crucial, because the guru becomes a kind of gateway or symbol of the Buddha, through which the disciple, by using that guru as a kind of lens through which to see the Buddha, the disciple can really receive the blessing of the Buddha by that disciple's faith. As I say, even the guru might be an idiot. However, of course, it's very important, even in that case, not to pick an idiotic guru or just casually just grab the first guru who wanders down. Because the thing is that while you're trying to use the guru as a lens to see the Buddha, the idiotic guru will think up a lot of stupid activities for you to engage in. And he will make you go out and do a lot of things and get him a lot of money and go and run around and march around and do a lot of asinine behaviors. And these things will distract you, so you're trying to look at the lens. Meanwhile, he's having you run up and down, digging ditches and doing all many stupid things. So they say, actually, there's a Tibetan proverb, Taratoku, used to say, I think it's very amusing, about this kind of special tantric guru who you must, it's very important, if you do receive initiation, you must see as Buddha, even, as I say, if on an ordinary level they behave like a fool. Taratoku said, get an initiation from a guru who lives at least three valleys away. This is apparently Kamba proverb, I think. At least 3 days' journey by yak, so that you don't see too often, you see. You don't have to see some of the ordinary behaviors. You see, you just see them in special occasion, ritual, then they're very nice, and this is Buddha's lens towards me. And you don't have to all the time deal with all the daily activities, you see, because then the idiotic things might come out, and you'd have to have really strong faith indeed to continue to see the guru in this sort of pea-brained character who is behaving like a fool. And some, there are a few pea brains, even in Tibet, one or two. Present company definitely accepts. our Rinpoche is a kind of child prodigy in Tibet. He was the youngest, he'll get red face now, he was the youngest person ever to receive the Geshe first degree, national Geshe degree, that is spiritual teacher degree. He received at the youngest age in Tibetan history. Of course, we're not too sure about that because Tibetans never know how old they are since they have no birth certificate. But in any case, he is known as, he was a real prodigy, you know, our Rinpoche. So I'm accepting him from some of my jokes. In any case, so there are these levels and layers of guru relationship depending upon which layer you are. But so that statement of Adishas, I understand and agree, that's totally agreed, that when you want to talk about book learning as something which one can sort of use to manipulate, you know, like, I know a lot about the Dharma because I read this and that book, you know, like the bad professors do, you know, they read all these things, you know, and they think they know a lot because they have this lot of footnotes and so forth. But because they're keeping kind of intellectual control of that, they're not letting it touch their heart, they're not practicing it, then it is from that point of view that someone like Atisha, or that you generally hear in the tradition, that there's something wrong with the book, you know, that books are like just mere books. But it isn't really the book that is mere, it is the way people treat the book. They use it to enhance their ego trip rather than to erode their ego trip. But that's not the book's fault. And as a final proof to defend the book, Rinpoche, I'm going to point to Manjushri's left shoulder. On the lotus, there's a book. A book. Now that's the book of Prajnaparamita. And that book, in fact, even in the book says, the only book that's any good is the book that is no book. Prajnaparamita is the book that says there is no book. It's the wisdom that says there is no wisdom to attain, you know, like in the Heart Sutra, it's that kind of a book. It's the bookless book, but it is a book, and he holds it as a book. Because on the other hand, you see, one of the dangers in Tibet, for example, the great masters in Tibet, such as Atisha also said that thing. Atisha also worked his life to translate the Indian books into Tibetan. And he always said, look, somebody comes along, new Guruji, they say they have new teaching. Oh, yeah, this new thing. Oh, Buddha didn't really say this. You don't know it. It's this unspoken thing. I heard it. I found it under a rock. And what it is to do this and do this and do that. A lot of weird thing came out in ancient time in Tibet, not just in modern time. A lot of very strange things. This is the Dharma and that is the Dharma. And who is there to control this? If anybody says, I'm a guru and I say it, then some Buddha told me last night in my dream, or I found it someplace in a stream or something. The thing is, Atisha says, what is in the sutras of the Buddha, what is preserved by these archangels, Manjushri, Maitreya, who are not disturbed by political events, by burning libraries, they can recover the books from their own hearts. What the guru says, I'm a guru. Yes, the guru's precept is good because they personally apply it to you. But if what they say does not agree with what is in the authoritative sutras and shastras, reject it. Am I right, Dimitri?
No.
So, I just had to do that before we get back to the book. Otherwise, there's some nervousness about this sutra. Anyway, this sutra is most amusing sutra and most interesting. I wanted to go on. I'm going to jump around a little bit. I'm going to move into the third chapter and then I'm going to go backwards a little bit to the Pure Land. I'm going to sort of go back and forth. But first, because of what Rinpoche was saying about empty sitting, I wanted to show that Rinpoche is very much according to the book. Because, for example, now Vimalakirti is sick, remember, and first he gives long talk about how awful it is to be sick, how the human body is such a letdown, how you really shouldn't be attached to the ordinary body and don't overfuss and don't waste your budget on it and don't do anything because it's just like not very worthwhile, it's not reliable, it's fundamental, illness is its fundamental nature. It's just really a balance of different illnesses, you know, all those viruses are all running around right now, up and down your bloodstream and your liver, just as long as they sort of stay in balance, you know, the sort of rodeo of viruses that are running around, everything is all right. One gets a little much, then we think we're sick, but in fact, the sicknesses are there all the time. He's saying like that, Vimalakirti is, right? Now, the last thing that he says, after he has delivered this talk to his friends, in the beginning of the third chapter of this translation, the way the number goes in this translation, he thinks to himself, he says, I am sick, lying on my bed in pain. Yet the Tathagata, the Buddha, that means the Buddha, the Tathagata means the Buddha, meaning one who has realized the ultimate nature of reality. That particular name means, so I translate it nowadays as transcendent Lord. He realizes the transcendent reality of the world. Yet the Tathagata, the saint, the perfectly accomplished Buddha, does not consider me or take pity upon me, and sends no one to inquire after my illness. So he's blaming the Buddha there. He's saying, this is really nasty. The Buddha is supposed to be omniscient. He said, the Buddha is omniscient, by definition. He's supposed to know everything. I'm so sick. I'm a nice old pious Buddhist layman. I've been supporting these monks for years, feeding them lunch and so on. I'm like, now I'm sick. He sends no one to see me. This is, of course, he's only pretending to be sick, and now he's pretending to be piqued, because Buddha doesn't send anyone to visit him. So Buddha reads his mind from 40 miles away out there in the Omega, you know. And he says, the Lord knew this thought in the mind of Vimalakirti and said to the Venerable Shariputra, Shariputra, go to inquire after the illness of the Lichavi Vimalakirti. And this is a formality in Buddhist culture. There's a set thing you'll see that they're supposed to say. When someone's sick in the community, everyone goes and pays a call on them and bothers them in various ways, says, how are you? Or is it too bad? Can I do anything for you? And usually gives them somewhat of a lecture, you know, like, you know, well, sickness is bad karma, so you should meditate and purify, blah, 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 usually this kind of thing. This is like a formality, to use the sickness as part of the path, you see, to encourage that member of the community to do this. So Shariputra really can't refuse when the Buddha says, go inquire after Vimalakirti. It's his duty as a saint, as an elder. Besides, the Buddha asked him to go. But you think he'd run right away, right? But notice, he does more or less refuse. He says, oh no, Buddha, I think, oh Lord, he said, I am indeed reluctant to go ask the Lichavi Vimalakirti about his illness. He says. Why? Because he's not supposed to refuse this. He's supposed to go impartially to all beings, even like, you know, enemies, vipers, snakes, anything. And he won't go see Vimalakirti? Now you see why people, about what you'd mean about Dharma talk that hits the point, you know, that maybe hurts a little. Here is great saint, doesn't want to go see this guy. And why? He tells the story why. He says, why? And I will read the story because it's so much on the point of meditation. I remember one day when I was sitting at the foot of a tree in the forest, absorbed in contemplation, and the Lichavi Vimalakirti came to the foot of that tree and said to me, now I want you to know that this is Shariputra talking, who is a saint. He's an arhat. Okay? Now, as an arhat, this means that he really has attained kind of enlightenment. What they call shravaka bodhi, the enlightenment of a disciple, he has attained that. He has realized a kind of selflessness, a level of selflessness. He has experienced himself as completely selfless. He has definitely had that experience. Not only that, but he has such a great power of samadhi that there was a famous story about how one time he was meditating and Mahamoggallana saw there was a little devil, kind of a, you know, some evil ogre like a gremlin, who'd come out of the forest and was hitting on his head with the hammer. Hitting Shariputra on the head, banging on him with a hammer, like one of like Steven Spielberg's little gremlins. It was going like bang, bang on Shariputra's head. Shariputra was not budging from his samadhi. So he chased away the gremlin, Mahamoggallana did, And then he woke up Chaiputra and said, Chaiputra, how do you feel? What's the matter with you? Didn't you know someone was beating on your head? And Chaiputra said, no, I didn't know. Oh, gee, I have a headache. Ooh, Chaiputra had a headache that time. Now this, those of you who have done some sitting will recognize, is a real achievement of trance. If you attain such a degree, and it isn't even that hard to attain, actually. You can actually withdraw from your senses, your mental energy, and go into inner mental realms of samadhi, and you really won't feel when someone talks to you, when someone... It's not that hard. After all, every one of you has probably had the experience when you're watching the baseball game, you know, the New York Yankees or the Red Sox, whatever city you come from, and somebody was talking to you, didn't hear what they said. Even they're shouting loudly. Children and wives sometimes, or husbands, they get this frustrating experience. They say, dear, dear, and the guy is staring at the tube. This happens to me a lot. So there you've withdrawn your attention from that sense because it's so associated to the visual sense in that occasion. So it's not that hard to withdraw from all of the senses, including the touch sense, and someone could hit you on the head, you wouldn't know, but it's not that easy. Anyway, so I'm just saying that Shariputra is an adept yogi and meditator. He is no lightweight. He's not just, you know, just sitting there thinking something on his pillow. He really can go into samadhi. So when he says, when I was sitting in the forest, absorbed in contemplation, he really was absorbed in contemplation, what we would consider a great yogi. So Lichavi Vimalakirti came to the foot of that tree and said to me, shook him probably, Reverend Shariputra, this is not the way to absorb yourself in contemplation. Or without even being asked. Note how rude the fellow is. He comes up and here's famous monk, great saint. This is like St. Peter, St. Paul or somebody. This is a great saint. He always stands on the Buddha's left hand, you know. Shariputra is not just some wandering monk, you know. He says, that's not the way to meditate. You should absorb yourself in contemplation so that neither body nor mind appear anywhere in the triple world. That's a very radical statement. That's the only way to meditate, that neither body nor mind are appearing anywhere within the triple world. Actually, those of you who know about Zen probably will remember the famous statement which caused Dogen's enlightenment, where he heard his guru tell another person that who had fallen asleep in a long Zen meditation sitting, set a session in China, you should cast off body and mind. Only meditate. You are only practicing Zazen when you cast off body and mind, he said to him. And this enlightened Dogen. It somehow, if you were practicing, it also ties back to another famous Zen thing where there was one guy, I remember today, this you might not know the story, where there was one guy called Huang Bo, famous meditator. Baijiang. And he was meditating, you know, like this, outside in this place in mountains in China. And the snow would fall on him, rain, thunder, lightning, hot, anything. He sat there, didn't care. Bugs could eat him up. He was just totally like this. So he had one guru, whose name was Master Ma Zi. And this guru used to come out, and he was a very irritating fellow, this kind of guru. And he used to sit next to him. He'd come out and sit sometimes, occasionally, while the guy would sit there day and night, you know. And the guru would come, and he would pick up some piece of tile, you know, like broken roof tile, you know, terracotta. And he'd rub the tile like this. Long time. And so the guy would think, you know, trying to disturb my samadhi, but he wouldn't budge, you know, sit there. Finally, after many weeks, like every day, so many periods of time, come out and do this, he became kind of irritated. So he finally became exasperated. He said, you know, Guruji, you know, Master Ma, what are you doing rubbing this tile? He said. So the guy looked up very offended. You know, the guru said, why? He says, I'm making a mirror. So the guy says, you can't make a mirror polishing a tile. And then the guru raised himself up and says, you can't make enlightenment by meditating. But this is similar, you know. In other words, if you think you're sitting meditating, if you're sort of, your body is sitting down and your mind is, now I'm meditating, I'm the good Buddhist, I'm the yogi, I'm going to get enlightenment, I'm concentrating, something like that, this is not the way to meditate. Only meditate when you aren't even appearing there, when neither body nor mind are apparent or anywhere within the triple world. Body and mind have been cast off. That's very, very radical, he says. Then he gets worse. That's just the beginning. He says, you should absorb yourself in contemplation in such a way that you can manifest all ordinary behavior without forsaking nirvana. You can just act like walking around. You don't have to go and sit on some pillow and look rigid and be uptight. You should be so absorbed in contemplation, you can go around and do anything and you never leave nirvana. This is the non-dualistic type of absorption that you should practice, he says. You should absorb yourself in contemplation in such a way that you can manifest the nature of an ordinary person without abandoning your cultivated spiritual nature. This, of course, is difficult for Shariputra. He's saying to Shariputra, I know you're a big saint. I'm not asking you to quit being a saint, but you could be all totally ordinary as well. What is the subtle egotism you have of I'm a saint? Why can't you just be an ordinary person as well? That's the way you should absorb yourself in contemplation. So there's no duality between even Buddha and ordinary person, much less you, the saint, and ordinary person. You should absorb yourself in contemplation so that the mind neither settles within nor moves without toward external form. You should absorb yourself in contemplation in such a way that the 37 accessories to enlightenment, these are things like faith, mindfulness, concentration, effort, alertness, etc., many things. There are 37 of them. The 37 aids to enlightenment are manifest without deviation towards any false conviction. You should absorb yourself in contemplation in such a way that you are released in liberation without abandoning the passions that are the province of the world. Here also, Shariputra is nervous. Shariputra has no passions, has no anger, has no delusion on the conscious mind at all. Perhaps the Mahayanist would say he has in his unconscious mind something, still, some seeds. But as a true saint, he genuinely has no such thing. So this is, again, a very radical statement that he should rediscover the energy of the passions that actually are still latent within him and make him actually no different from ordinary persons. And he should be liberated without having to abandon those. It's a very difficult business he is talking about. Reverend Shariputra, those who absorb themselves in contemplation in such a way are declared by the Lord to be truly absorbed in contemplation. Then Shariputra, you know, goes back to his own discourse. He says, Lord, when I heard this teaching, I was unable to reply and had to remain silent. Therefore, I am reluctant to go to ask that good man about his sickness. He's so scared, you know, he might go up and say, how are you, Vimalakirti? He said, what are you asking me? Who are you? Who are me? You know, Vimalakirti might just start out on this kind of ultimate reality binge and like drive poor Shariputra mad. So this is a tremendously radical thing, especially Shariputra. See, you have to know from a Buddhist culture, Shariputra is like St. Peter or St. Paul. It's like coming up to St. Peter and saying, you're a jerk, you know, you're not a Christian, you're an idiot. Somebody saying to him, like some guy from downtown Jerusalem, you know, saying to him. It would be equivalent in Christian literature like that. It's an incredibly radical thing.